Give me just one more night. Please give me just one more night. Give me just one more night. Cause I can't wait forever. Please give me just one more night. Oh, give me just one more night. Oh, give me just one more night. Cause I can't wait for the hardest part of the ring. The hardest part of the ring. Sometimes you go over the top rope and you bang your head on the ring apron. Why do you do that? That's when you feel like a big dope. They're the worst bumps you can be taking. Oh, it's the hardest part of the ring. Hey, the hardest part of the ring. One more. Sometimes you reach out for the hot tag and you go ahead and make your own comeback. That's when you should quit wrestling and you're better off rolling in thumbtacks. The hardest part of the ring. The hardest part of the ring. Now double claps. Clap, 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 clap. The hardest part of the ring. The hardest part of the ring. Bada bada. Whoa! Yay! What is going on, Bob Squad? How are you? How's Tricks? How's the kids? Some weather we're having. Punching a clock, passing a buck, burning a midnight oil, burning a candle at both ends, working hard but hardly working, rubbing elbows, greasing palms, schmoozing, networking, networking. Hey everybody, what's going on, guys? Thank you for joining me to discuss the May 23rd. Oh goodness gracious, it's tragedy after tragedy. The May 23rd edition of WWE Monday Night Raw, of course, May 23rd. This is the, forgive me a second, this is the 23rd anniversary of the tragic death of Owen Hart. And also in the United States, if you're not aware, we had our weekly terrible school shooting. Let's talk about pro wrestling, yay! Okay. Alrighty. The May 23rd, 2002 Hulu edition. Say with me, folks, not limited enough commercial interruption. Let's just try to forget for a moment that everything is terrible. We're all going to get shot or we're going to get a pandemic and there's no health care. Even if you have health care, it's not real. And the skies are burning and the oceans are boiling. And there's no justice for Johnny yet, but there will be. There will be. I'm trying to stay positive. He's got to win this thing. I've watched every ounce of this trial. It's not healthy. It's ruining me. It's dragging me down. He had some great witnesses today, and his lawyers did a great job destroying her not-so-great witnesses yesterday. I'm just hoping that 7 random people on a jury in Virginia will understand what is going on. Imagine after 6 weeks of this shit, sitting through this stuff, 8 hours a day, at least on weekdays. They ask the jury, you know, do you have a verdict? And then one just says, we don't speak English. What the fuck have you been doing for 6 weeks? Crazy Americans. Okay. The show opens with Hulk Hogan slamming Blank the Giant. I can't read my writing. I don't know who it is. But he body slammed Blank the Giant, so I'm going to research that later. Let me know in the comments. Mark, this isn't really on you, Mark. I'll leave you alone. Be that as it may, that notwithstanding, all things considered, one thing leads to your mother. We have a very long package at the beginning of, like I called it, I hate to say I told you so, but Bob told you so. Of course, the Usos beat RK-Bro on SmackDown to become the Unified Tag Team Champions. And Riddle is alone, and Riddle is sad. This worked. I don't know what city they were in. I never looked, and they don't like to say anyway, so it's probably not a very big metropolitan area. Big area. Because if it was, they would have told me 5 times per second. Matt Riddle is sad, and this worked, because he's never sad. And you felt bad for him, his little puppy dog face. You felt bad for the guy. And I think sad Riddle works. Just don't do it all the time. And make sure you're blaming specific heels for it. so we can be mad at the heels for making Riddle sad. And it worked. This show mostly worked. Just the country's falling to shit. The Street Profits are coming out for some reason. I guess there's going to be a six-man tag team action. Well, the last time they started the show announcing a match with six people in it, that didn't go well. Be that as it may, Sami Zayn enters and the Usos enter, but they have a video thing, which I assume was pre-taped. Maybe not. Who cares? Where each Uso has a red belt and a blue belt from the respective brands. It would be great if one Uso had two red belts and the other had two blue belts. I'm like, no, this guy's the Raw champ. This guy's the SmackDown champions. But no one listens to Bob. Anyway, the Usos come out as well. But the thing is, when the Street Profits enter the arena for their sports entertainment contest, if you will, these empty red party cups, like the kind that college kids drink and piss beer out of, they fall from the ceiling, right? And these cups are all over the ramp. So now we have six guys and referees and officials breaking them up, all brawling on these six cups, which are getting trampled, which means someone's going to twist an ankle, blow out a knee, get killed. Everyone, you might as well just dump a big thing of marbles on the ramp and have them fight on that. Why would... I don't know. Maybe I'm thinking too much into it. It doesn't take much to hurt somebody. It doesn't. We saw what happened in AEW recently with Daniel Bryan getting his foot stuck in the ring. And it took the idiots 18 minutes, a bunch of so-called wrestlers... took him 8 minutes to figure out, hey, let's just actually move the ring if we can't move the ramp. Because here's the thing about rings. They move. All you needed was three dudes to get, not on the side with the ramp or the side opposite ramp, the ramp, the two sides parallel with the ramp. Give it a 1, 2, 3 heave. Move it over an inch. Get his foot out. Put it back down. Really, a Wardlow and a Hobbs, those two could have just come out and done a shove or a pull. And this would have been done. I mean, they're filming, but they're not putting it on TV, even though they're going to YouTube the fuck out of it. Whatever, I got sidetracked. I didn't like brawling on the cup. Someone's going to blow a knee up. And this roster, if someone's not getting fired, they're leaving or walking out or requesting their release or getting hurt or getting COVID or something all the time. As the Raw show gets longer, the roster gets smaller every week, so you don't want six people that you use a lot brawling and on a wacky surface. Okay? Don't do that. I didn't like that part. Anyway, a six-man tag match was fine. Nothing to write home about. And again, why would I bother my mother with this information? Nitpick. No, it's not a nitpick. It's a complaint. Fuck it. Barry and referee. Usos started their main heat spot with pulling a rope down so Riddle can run the rope and take the tumble backwards over right in front of the referee. Referee stared right at it, put his thumb up his asshole, and we went to break. Stop that. Here's what I liked. I like the fact that Riddle, even with tape on his ribs, he's a babyface, and he's pissed off. And he's able to bump Sammy, Jimmy, and Jay. And even though they don't like their bump and feed hot tags, they haven't liked those things in like 20 years. Vince hates them for some reason. They work. So the wrestlers have been creative in each ones and try not to do punch, line, slam. You can't line mean clothesline, but you know what I mean? So they've gotten around it. I'll hit you with this move, and then you run in and you swing in and I'll duck and I'll hit you with this different, and it's the same, but it's different. Like, okay, fine. I still don't think, I don't know, I think it's a silly rule, but I'm going to lose this battle. Anyway, Riddle bumping all the heels and getting pissed off about it, and doing the kicks to one of the Usos in the corner. I like all that. They do the finish, which I liked. Both Usos are standing on the ring apron, the hardest part of the ring. And they're mouthing off to Riddle, and they both jump back off. And you hear this big clang, because I think one of the sneakers of the Usos hit what used to be a ring skirt around the apron, hardest part of the ring. But instead, now it's like an LED board that lights up and does all kinds of bullshit. So you heard that clang of that happening, and I just kind of laughed. I'm like, okay. Things changed. But anyway, Riddle hits the RKO in tribute to his friend Randy Orton, who was injured. 1, 2, 3 is perfect finish. It showed Riddle's not backing down. The babyface is mad, and he's not mad enough to cheat, but he's mad enough to get pissed off and be aggressive. So they run away, but why wouldn't Riddle chase him? Thankfully, because the match is still going on, he's got Sami Zayn right behind him. So by the time he hits the move and gets the pin, now the Russos are all the way. Russos, Jesus Christ, that would be the worst. The Usos are all the way up at the top of the ramp, and he has a reason to not chase them. So that was good. And the Profits are there just so they're not having a... So Riddle's not beating them in a 1-3 match. Profits are utility guys in this role. It's not bad, but it's what it is. Okie dokie. So that was very good. Pretty good, right? 10.5 minutes in? Okay, I'm going to start making these faster. I hope the quality doesn't go down. I think it'll be better, but... I'm getting a little carried away sometimes, Bob Squad. Bobby Lashley is still feuding with Omos, LOLOL. And Bobby Lashley, oh, bless him, bless his cotton socks. He comes out and cuts a promo? We'll call it that. Anyway, listen, he challenges Bobby, he challenges Omos to wrestle him for the fourth time. Why are they doing this to us? To them? To Bobby? Why are they doing this to Bobby? I'll laugh, but poor Bobby. Hollywood hates Bobs, I tell you. Hell in a Cell. I don't know when it is. They said it's this Sunday, but I don't think that's true. I think they actually... Because this Sunday is the AEW pay-per-view, so they're not double-booking that. Who knows? Anyway. Another person said two Sundays. I don't know. I think whatever. Jimmy Smith, John Smith, whatever messed the damn thing up. I wrote LOLOL several times with a smiley face because that was funny to me that they were going to make us watch this match again in just a bigger cage. Then some stuff happened. MVP interrupted and Omos is in a suit. And I guess MVP and Bobby, they took a long time to set this up. Lashley and MVP will wrestle later. Winner chooses the stipulation for Hell in a Cell. Except Hell in a Cell is a stipulation. Actually, that's not correct. Hell in a Cell is a gimmick. A stipulation is winner gets this, loser doesn't get that. Or loser gets this, winner doesn't get that. That's a stipulation. But either way, it's two gimmicks instead of one. So it's a gimmick for a gimmick match. Silly, silly, silly. Too much. And it makes the main event Hell in a Cell match, which I assume is Seth and Cody. We established this last week. It makes their thing look like it means less. But... it'll be a good enough match to make up for it and be a realistic main event while Roman decides to do whatever Roman's doing. There's a long package about Asuka and Becky, and then Adam Pearce is talking to Dana Brooke, who is the 24/7 champion. Did you know that? I did not know that. I have not seen her on the Hulu edition. Probably not in 2022. So she still has that thing, and Becky knocks into her, and I thought they were going to set up Becky wrestling Dana, or Becky just jumping Dana, because they don't have real matches for that thing, and somehow Becky ending up with the 24/7 championship but being mad about it because it's a joke title. My imagination ran wild with me, but they didn't do anything with it. Maybe later. Maybe Dana will be the keep Becky busy for a month person to hold her off till something else over the summer. I don't know. So this sets up Becky versus Asuka again. Same main event 2 weeks in a row. And if Becky wins, another stipulation, after we set up a stipulation, just want to point that out. If Becky wins against Asuka, she'll be added to Asuka versus Bianca at Hell in a Cell, and it will be a three-way. We know Becky's going to win, because they want stars on their show, because Roman is doing whatever Roman is doing. The Blue Light Special is next, the Judgment Day group. I wasn't the biggest fan of the mixed tag, basically... Edge and Damien and Rhea talked for a long time, mostly Edge, and they set up the mixed tag team match of Rhea Ripley, who is a woman with female genitals, and her teammate Damien Priest, who is a male with male genitals, versus AJ Styles, who is a male with male genitals, and Liv Morgan, who is a female with female genitals. All these things to the best of my knowledge, okay? So, just want to make that clear. Rhea and Damien versus AJ Styles and Liv Morgan. This is my favorite. This specific week was my favorite version of this group. They were assholes. They were dark and spooky, but it wasn't so dark and spooky that I couldn't believe them. They just, Edge ran down the people pretty good without lazy, your hometown sports team sucks kind of bullshit. No, he tried to dig at them a little more harder to the core about their jobs and their office and their boss and this, that, and the other thing. And to win the match, I love this. They were selling it as though Liv might have had Rhea's number. Maybe, maybe not. They didn't have Liv have Rhea pinned with, like, a bumped referee or something like that. They didn't make it so, like, look, Liv can beat Rhea. No. They were... Liv was making a comeback and gaining steam, and that's all that really mattered. And she goes for her finishing maneuver with on Rhea Ripley. But to prevent Liv from completing a maneuver, Edge reaches in and he grabs the back of Rhea's belt or her tights, you know, which thankfully held together and there wasn't any butt crack of any kind exposed, because that could have been a thing. I haven't checked Beth Phoenix's Twitter yet. She probably tweeted something funny about that, I'm sure. But either way, that causes Liv to bounce backward and Rhea to lay on top of her and smush her for a big pin. And then the bad guys beat up the good guys, and then Rhea hits the finishing maneuver on Liv Morgan, and they all pose and they laugh, the heels do. And the Blue Light Special is victorious. The Blue Light Special, this is the best. This specific week was the best they've ever been. Much better. So, yay. Mostly positive stuff going on here. Seth Rollins is talking to an Irish guy, and he ends what he says by laughing. He doesn't like Cody Rhodes since he's been back. That is all. Asuka is talking to a blonde lady. I forgot what she said to the blonde lady. She did the baby, big time baby thing about Becky. That was that. The Miz enters the ring and we go to break. And we return to Miz and Cody. Miz and Cody, to my surprise, had a one segment match. They just kind of wrestled the normal babyface versus heel. No real issue, so mostly scientific type of match. Cody working a headlock takedown, and Miz going for the head scissors, Cody getting out of it, all that kind of good stuff. All that stuff I like. I didn't think Miz was keeping up with Cody. There's a good sloppy where it looks like there's a bit of a struggle, where you don't want things looking too smooth. But there's also a bad sloppy, like for a timing thing. Because Miz is, lately he hasn't been doing matches. Not in the last, when I say lately, not this year and not most years. There was like a sunset flip that was kind of clunky and with a hesitation, but he did it like off the second rope where you twist. It's actually not that hard to do. Yes, I've done it. Where you just kind of twist and grab the guy's waist and the rest of it takes care of itself. All that kind of stuff. It looked to me, and Miz's strike... Miz, I thought, was just being outclassed by Cody here. And again, I know Cody's the face, and it's Miz's job to make Cody look good. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about performance-wise. I think Cody was on his game. And Cody does the thing at the top where he takes his weight belt, he gives it to a kid. Cody was a wonderful babyface here, and it even gets better. Because there's a disqualification. Seth Rollins knocks Cody off the top rope and causes him to fall to the floor pretty quickly. And there's a disqualification, of course. Rams Cody's knee into the stairs. And he takes... And Seth does this. And I thought this was a good piece of business right here. Seth, out of nowhere. He doesn't make a big production out of it. He actually snatches it out of nowhere. He grabs the belt back from the kid. The same kid. And then he whips Cody really hard with it, leaves some red marks and well, and you know, enough that you can see. And thankfully drops it in front of Cody. And my nitpick here, and again, I don't know if it's a nitpick or a complaint, it went on a little bit too long for the viewer to go, does Cody have no friends? Or no officials, no referees help them? It just took a little too long. I think if they took out the big whip into the stairs, it should be enough that Seth knocks him off. He takes a big fall from the top turnbuckle to the floor. Then go do the belt thing and get out of there. And then referees can start showing up. it was just one referee waving, doing nothing. And just to me, it was just too long before somebody wouldn't come out. They established he's friends with Randy Orton, and they told us Randy Orton's not there, okay. But somebody could have come out in that time. I thought it was a little too, but yet when there's a six-man tag, and we're not expecting a brawl on top of paper cups, plastic cups, whatever, 18 officials are ready in the back, all run out the exact same time. They're all standing at the curtain, ready to break it up. There's just not you need consistency. But this is the part that I love. A good old school babyface move. As Cody sells up, and he doesn't want help, and thankfully, even though it makes sense for the referee to help him, he wouldn't let anyone else get in a camera shot. good for him. And he limps over, and he makes sure, and he doesn't make a big production out of it, even though you know what he's going to do. He gives that belt back to the kid. He doesn't really look at the kid. He's selling his injuries, but he just kind of puts it over that barricade and just kind of taps it with his hand so he makes sure that kid gets it again. The kid held it up, thankfully. I have no idea if the kid was a plant or a real fan or whatnot. I don't fucking know. It's very possible the kid is the son or nephew of a ring crew or referee or something. If not, or one of the wrestlers. I don't know, okay? And I hope we don't know. If it turns out to be, I'm making this up, I don't know. Kevin Owens, was he on a show? He wasn't on Hulu Edition. Kevin Owens has like 5 kids, right? And AJ Styles got like 18 kids or whatever the hell it is. If it was one of their kids, cool. I don't want to know. And I hope I don't see it on Twitter. Leave it. Just leave it. It's better if we don't know, for sure. Leave doubt, because that's how you believe your baby faces in your heels. So he makes sure, as much pain as he's in, he makes sure the kid gets that belt back. And I thought it was very cool. Good babyface moment. Sappy, a little, but I don't know. Hey guys, sometimes maybe sappy is what we need. Alright? So I love all this. I'm happy here. I'm a happy viewer. Country's going to hell. An Irish guy is talking to Cody Rhodes. Cody Rhodes doesn't say anything about the belt. He doesn't put himself over in that way. But he says, basically just talks about Seth Rollins, and he says, all right, do you really want to be 0-3 against me? Because we're going to do this Hell in a Cell, and blah, 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 blah. And Cody doesn't make, and here's another good babyface thing, he doesn't make promises. He doesn't promise I'm going to pin or submit Seth Rollins in the middle of the ring at Hell in a Cell. And he says he's going to fight with everything he's got and beat the living shit out of Seth Rollins, more or less. And that's all he needs to say. He's letting us know we're going to see a fight. And that's good, because we've seen 2 wrestling matches from them. So now let's see a fight. That's good stuff. MVP and Bobby Lashley have that match. Nothing to write home about here. They do a screwy count-out finish. MVP wins by count-out, because Omos is jumping Bobby Lashley, and the referee does not suspect this 12-foot tall man who's doing things slowly behind his back could possibly be taking place. I don't know. Anyway, Lashley runs in, and before we hear from MVP what's his stipulation, Lashley puts him in the hurt lock, and yay, he puts the manager in a hold and teaches him a lesson, and that's what he gets for cheating. But we kind of wanted to hear what the stipulation was, but I think they were teasing that for next week, so I'm sure I could wait. I hope it's some kind of loser leaves town thing, but anyway, Bianca Belair is at ringside. Becky and Asuka wrestle again for the second time in a row, the second main event. Becky's got her bumping shoes on the last 2 weeks. Asuka's given her the German suplexes and the kicks and yada yada yada. Instead of Becky throwing. Last week, Becky probably threw Asuka into Bianca or something like that to get Bianca to stand up. Because Bianca's sitting there. I don't remember if she wasn't on commentary this week. I don't remember if she was last week. She might have been for, like, up until her part in the finish or something like that. I really don't remember. But anyway, they do a thing where Becky ends up on Bianca's lap. Asuka goes for the kick, and Asuka, of course, Becky moves. Asuka errantly kicks Bianca in the head, which You need to do that obligatory thing, because otherwise it's just going to be two. It would just be two baby faces beating the shit out of Becky, and there'd be no reason to believe that there's any kind of threat or menace to Becky sneaking her way back into winning the championship. So you have to do something to make the other two not like each other when there's one antagonist in a situation. That's a problem with three ways. I think I'd always prefer a face and two heels, quite frankly. I think when it's two faces and a heel, now we have to do this. And now we have to split the audience. I don't know. I like two heels pounding on that face, but then, of course, they try to backstab each other over who gets the pin, and the face recovers and beats them both, and yada, yada, yada. Anyway, they have this match. Pretty good. And no green mist this time. No missed opportunities, LOL. It looks like Becky's going to... This is really strange. It looks like Becky's going to win by countout, which would have been back-to-back two screwy countout finishes. Again, what's happening? Is no one consulting with anyone else when we write these things? But it looked like it was gonna happen. I really thought it was. And then this... Something was odd, because Asuka rolls in and stays on her belly, and Becky kind of sneaks her up into a sunset flip. A really weakly, badly covered sunset flip, and Becky's mechanics are way better than that. So it really surprised me that Becky would do this kind of weird, weak cover. You remember when Owen dropped... Oh, Jesus Christ, at the end of it, no. When Owen dropped Austin on his head at SummerSlam 97, and he forced Austin basically to do that really nonchalant, weak roll-up pin where Owen just held Austin's arm and forced himself to be rolled up or whatever the hell it was. This wasn't anything that bad, but it reminded me of it because it was just this strange, nonchalant, sunset flip type pin, and Asuka stayed down and then got up shocked, but nothing was... There were no feet on her shoulders. There was no reason for her to... She was just squirming like a turtle, like a turtle had been turned over, like she just magically couldn't get up. It didn't make a lot of sense at all. I'm wondering if something went screwy and Asuka was supposed to stay in and get countered out, and Becky just said to hell with it, stay down, or something, because something was odd. And it couldn't have been a TV time thing. I was thinking about that, too. Because at least on the Hulu edition, you had, like, a minute after the bell, still. So that couldn't have been it. I was odd. I don't know. But anyway, Becky wins, and of course now it's going to be the three of them at Hell in a Cell. And that was that. And they had their graphic all ready to go. And... Okay, then. That was Monday Night Raw. Hulu edition. Anything else going on this week, Bob Squad? Let me think. Oh, this Thursday night, I got the Comedy Store in La Jolla. Tell some jokes to the people. You're not going to believe this. Yeah, maybe you will. I'm a trustworthy guy. But I actually finished the first 3-minute scene to my Aquaman Sunbob video. Can you believe that? Yeah. And it's not... Usually I start off with some talking, some slow setup. This one starts the action pretty quickly. This one, we jump into it pretty quickly, and we catch up from there on whatever's happening is happening. So I think I'm going to go funnier with this one. I hope it's shorter. It's not going to be 40 minutes like the Batman one. That's for sure. I hope it's half as long, and maybe even a little less, but who knows with me. I get carried away, and I get an idea, and yada, yada, yada. But anyway, I think these things are going to start... I'm going to try to make them a little funnier with the dialogue, which I didn't want to do originally. I didn't want to just be, oh, that's the guy who makes the jokes about G.I. Joe and He-Man, etc., etc. But, you know, people like me better when I'm funny, okay? So... Nobody cares about Bob's message, so you just deal with it. So we're going to make it. This one's got some jokes. And other than that, how can you just walk away from me when all I can do is watch you leave? 'Cause we shared the laughter and the pain. and even shared the tears. You're the only one who really knew me at all. So take a look at me now. Oh, that's just an empty space. And there's nothing left here to remind me of just a memory of your face. But take a look at me now. Sing it. That's just an empty space. And you coming back to me is against all odds. And that's why I've got to face. Take a look at me now. On the hardest part of the ring. Ba-da-ba-da-ba.